Hi, in this module, I'm going to talk about how to use feature templates to organize and construct your features in a very flexible way. So recall that a hypothesis class is a set of all predictors that a learning algorithm is going to consider. And then in case of linear predictors, we've looked at predictors of a function of x to be equal to, in the case of regression, w dot phi of x, or in the case of classification, sine of that quantity. And we allow the wave vectors to vary freely. Okay, so we can visualize the hypothesis class as follows. So imagine the space of all possible predictors, all possible functions mapping x to y. When you define a feature extractor phi, what you're doing is committing to a particular subset of the all possible predictors. And usually you do this by using prior knowledge. And the second part is the learning algorithm, where you're given script f, the hypothesis class, and you're asking the learning algorithm to choose a particular predictor from that set based on data. So intuitively, we want the script f hypothesis class to contain the good predictors, of course, but it can also contain some bad ones because they will be filtered out based on the basis of data, but we don't want it to be too big so that the learning algorithm has a trouble identifying good predictors from the bad predictors. So let's look at an example task, and I want to give you an idea of how to choose the feature extractor. So suppose you're given a string, such as abc@gmail.com, and you're asked to predict whether this is a valid email address or not using a linear classifier. So in this case, what we have to do is to identify the feature extractor. So when you're designing a feature extractor, the main question you ask yourself is what properties of the input X might be relevant for predicting Y? Of course, you don't want to necessarily commit to a particular aspect to be important because you don't know, you want to learn that from data, but you should give the learning algorithm some guidance. So what we're going to do is define the feature extractor as given X, produce a set of feature name, feature value pairs. So in this particular example, the feature extractor is going to produce a feature vector. And let's say in this case, we might look at the length, is it greater than 10? In case it's 1, because length has something to do with whether it's a valid email address. The fraction of alphanumeric characters, 0.85 in this case. Does it contain an at sign? That's 1, because it does contain an at sign. Ends with com, and it's 1 here. And does it end with .org? And it's 0 here. Okay, so this is a feature vector for that we might construct for this particular application. So now we go to prediction. So remember that we've previously defined the feature vector to just be a real vector. It's just a list of numbers. So what we've done right now is to just annotate or comment each component of that feature vector with a name that describes what that component is about. We can do the same thing with the corresponding wave vector. So here is a wave vector, just a list of numbers, and we can annotate each component with the name of the corresponding feature. And recall that the score is just the dot product, w dot phi of x, and just to write out the dot product, it's a sum over all the features or components of wj, the weight of that feature, times the feature value. Okay, so here's an example. The weight of length greater than 10 is minus 1.2. The feature value is 1. So you have that product here, and you have all the other features. So a little piece of intuition here is that you can think about the score. Remember, in classification, positive scores are result in positive classification. Negative scores result in negative classification. You can think about each feature as providing a vote. And you can think about if, let's say, phi of xj is 1. And wj, if it's positive, that means it's fading in favor of positive classification. And if WJ is negative, it's voting in favor of negative classification. And the magnitude of WJ determines the strength of the vote. So that's another way to interpret the dot product. Before, we previously saw that we can interpret as a cosine of the angle, which is a more geometric interpretation. So far, we've seen that we can take inputs, define arbitrary feature extractors, get out our feature vectors, and do learning. But how do we choose these feature vectors? I just kind of made up at, com, and org. Which ones do we include? So far, we've used some prior knowledge, but it's very easy in this manner to miss some. What about suffixes like ending in US, for example? We need a more systematic way of doing this. And this is where feature templates comes in. So a feature template is simply a group of features all computed in a similar way. So here's an example. So the input abc@gmail.com. We're going to write the feature template as simply an English description with a blank. And that blank is meant to be filled in with an arbitrary value. Last three characters equals something. And by instantiating that blank with all sorts of different values, then we begin to realize the feature vectors that are the features that are actually defined by this feature template. So the important part here is that we no longer have to say which suffixes are important. We don't have to say what types of patterns, what particular patterns to look at. We just have to know that there exists some suffix that might be important in defining this feature template, letting the learning algorithm sort out which of these many features are actually relevant. So to continue this example, so the input is abc@gmail.com. We define this feature template, which can be instantiated by substituting something like .com. We can also define this other feature template, length greater than blank, and we can plug in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and so on into that. Some feature templates don't have a blank, and that's okay, because that just corresponds to specifying one single feature, and that has a particular value. So here's another example. So suppose the input is an aerial image, along with some metadata about the location. So you can go figure out where this actually is. So the feature template in this case, we might want to look at the following. So we want to look at the pixel intensity of this image at a particular row and a particular column. And it's a color image, so there's three channels, RGB. So we identify a particular channel that we're looking at. So this might be instantiated as the pixel intensity of image at row 10 and column 93, red channel. And that might have a particular value. Another feature template might look at the metadata, the location, and be a feature on whether the latitude is in a particular range and longitude is in a particular range. So this feature template gets instantiated, might be instantiated with particular values that denote ranges. So this is, if you remember piecewise constant features, this is an example of piecewise constant features that carves up the world into a bunch of regions and has a feature firing if the lat long is in a particular region or not. So one thing you might know is that feature templates are pretty flexible, but sometimes they can give rise to a lot of features. Last character equals blank, and there's already 26 if you only include a lowercase letters. And furthermore, most of these feature values are zero. So in these cases, this is what we mean when a feature vector is sparse. And you can actually represent sparse feature vectors more compactly by just, as a dictionary, mapping the feature name to the actual feature value. So in general, there's two ways you can represent feature vectors. One is using arrays and one is using dictionaries. So if your feature vector looks like this, which is dense or not sparse, that means all the feature values are mostly non-zero. then you might want to just represent this as an array, order the feature somehow, and just list out the numbers. But in cases where your feature vector looks like this and has lots of zeros, then it would be more efficient to represent this as a dictionary where, you specify the feature name colon the feature value of only the non-zero elements. And by convention, anything that is not mentioned has a value of zero. So one interesting advantage of sparse features is that you don't have to a priori instantiate all the features in advance. You can kind of, as data comes, you only kind of lazily build up these features over time. Whereas if you were doing things in a dense way, you would have to predefine the fixed set of features that you're going to be working with. Now, in recent years with deep learning, dense features have and arrays have been much more ubiquitous, partly because you can take advantage of fast matrix computations on the GPU. So to summarize, we want to identify hypothesis classes. And in this case, we're looking at defining the hypothesis class with respect to the feature extractor. To define the feature extractor, we use feature templates, which is a convenient shorthand for unrolling a feature, single feature template into a bunch of different features. We also saw that in some cases, the feature vectors were sparse, and therefore you can use a dictionary implementation to be more efficient. Okay, so that's the end of this module. Thanks.